Dear students, I welcome you on the lecture series of Management Accounting. Today we shall take up Unit 2nd, and under Unit 2nd we shall take up its Part 3rd, where we have started up the discussion on the ratio analysis. Under ratio analysis, we are going to discuss in detail about the classification of ratio. In our previous lecture, we have learned that how we have classified the ratio on the basis of probability and the liquidity positions, that is the solvency position of the company. So, there are certain ratios which are based on turnover, certain on the asset classification, and how we are going to manage up the efficiency of conducting the business of a company, that is been known by the ratio analysis. So, continuing our discussion on the ratio analysis and classification of ratio thereon, we shall take up this lecture. Figures, when they are being scattered, they do not give any information, but when they are being used in relation to some base, we can derive some useful information, and that is what the ratio analysis is, where one figure is being informed or is being interpreted or expressed in relation to other, whether this base can be the balance sheet, income statement, P&L account or cash flows. So, taking these bases into consideration, we shall move ahead and learn in detail about the ratio analysis. We said that we have classified the ratio on the basis of probability, on the basis of activity, on the basis of solvency, where the short term position as well as long term positions can be assessed of a company. So, taking up the one of the bases, that is the solvency of the company, we will discuss certain ratios. So, the objective of this lecture is to analyze and understand one of the very fundamental concept in relation to the dew point chart, that is return on capital employed is to be ascertained. So, dew point chart is the basic premises by which we can ascertain the return on a capital or return on net worth. It is very important calculation and base of the ratio analysis, which we will learn in detail, the calculation aspect, the conceptual aspect of dew point chart. Then we will learn about the solvency ratios, how they are being determined, what they interpreted, and where they are being useful. And finally, we shall try to appreciate the advantages and disadvantages associated with using the tool of financial planning called ratio analysis. So, first of all, let us move ahead and learn about the dew point chart. There are three components in the calculation of return on equity using the traditional dew point model: the net profit margin, asset turnover, and the equity multiplier. By examining each input individually, the source of a company's return on equity can be discovered and compared to its competitor. So, here we can say that under the traditional dew point analysis, return on equity is to be computed where the three basic premises are being used: the net profit, where the profit margin are being computed, asset turnover, and one of the equity multiplier is being used. Why they are being used, what is their significance, and how they are being used, let us learn about them. First of all, net profit margin, which is one of the components of dew point chart to ascertain return on equity. The net profit margin, that is the net profit margin, is simply the after tax profit of a company generated for each rupee of revenue. So, we can compute it as net profit margin is equal to net income divided by revenue. So, we can say that the net income can be our after tax profit and revenues can be turnover. So, net profit or the net profit margin could be computed using this formula. Again, one thing we need to note is that net profit margin is a safety cushion. The lower the margin, the lesser the room for error. So, it should be on a lower side. Then, asset turnover is another component under dew point chart. Asset turnover, as the name suggests, it is a ratio which is a measure of how effectively a company converts its assets into sale. It is calculated as under: asset turnover is equal to revenue divided by assets, because what we are doing is that we are transforming the assets into sales, and by which we can generate income. So, it is a ratio of revenues to that of assets. So, again one of the premises which we need to keep in mind when we compute return on equity is that the asset turnover tends to be inversely related to the net profit margin. That is, the higher the net profit margin, the lower the asset turnover. And the last or the most important component of DuPont chart is equity multiplier. Now, what's this equity multiplier? What's the significance of using equity multiplier to ascertain return on equity? Let us understand it. It is possible for a company with terrible sales and margins to take on excessive debt and artificially increase its return on equity. The equity multiplier, a measure of financial leverage, allows the investor to see what proportion of the return on equity is the result of debt. The equity multiplier is calculated as follows. That is, equity multiplier is equal to assets divided by shareholders' equity. So, let us understand equity multiplier. Equity multiplier is nothing but an indicator that how much debt is being used to generate or to be in a position where a company can generate revenues. So, we simply say that it allows the investor to see the proportion of the return on equity which is result of debt. That means, if return on equity is being shown higher, let us analyze that how much it is because of the debt. So, financial leverage is being used, and the same formula to compute financial leverage either on income basis or balance sheet basis would be used so that we can ascertain our equity multiplier and can use it to find out the return on equity. So, let us understand its computation. Here, return on equity can be computed using the DuPont chart analysis, and its computation is return on equity is equal to net profit margin. That is the net profit divided by revenues. The way it is being computed, it is being multiplied by asset turnover, and then it is being multiplied by equity multiplier. And when we multiply all these components, computing it with the formulas being given, we can ascertain our return on equity using the DuPont analysis. So, we have presented it in a graphical manner where we will move from the right hand side and come to the left side. We have to find out return on equity. So, first of all, profit on margin is being computed. It is EBIT divided by sales. Then asset turnover is being computed, that is sales upon NA. NA means the net assets. When both of these factors are being computed, we reach to a situation where we have return on net assets, that is EBIT divided by NA. Because if we multiply profit margins and asset turnover, we can see that sales would be cut together. One is on the numerator side and another is on the denominator side. So, we are getting a formula as EBIT divided by net assets, that is our return on net assets. So, here we can say that our return of net asset is nothing but the multiplication of profit margin and asset turnover. So, when we have interpolated the formulas, we have been able to extract a formula for return on net asset, that is EBIT upon NA. Now, we will be having a financial leverage formula which we call as a equity multiplier. So, it can be on the basis of income, that is profit after tax, which we have written as PAT divided by EBIT, or on the basis of balance sheet where it is NA divided by NW, that is net assets divided by net worth. Either of the formulas can be used depending upon the information which is being furnished to us, and it can be used as our equity multiplier to ascertain the return on equity. And when we solve the formula, we are getting the formula as PAT divided by NW, that is profit after tax divided by net worth. Now, how we have come to this formula is that when EBIT divided by net asset is being multiplied by a financial leverage, that is PAT divided by EBIT, we are getting the formula as PAT, that is profit after tax divided by net assets or net worth. So, simplifying this formula, we are able to get the formula for return on equity, that is profit after tax divided by net worth. So, the exercise which we are doing under the DuPont chart analysis is to ascertain return on equity. we can simply use the formula as profit after tax divided by net worth. But how we have arrived at this formula, what are the components which are being used out there, it is exercise to ascertain it in a illustrative manner so that we can know that return on equity consists of profit margins, it consists of asset turnovers, and it consists of a equity indicator showing the impression or impact of the debts on the return on equity. So, in a very lucid manner, it is being described over here in a graphical manner that what is the mechanism or what is the method of ascertaining return on equity. Given the information, we can always ascertain return on equity using dew point chart. Now, the next topic to be discussed is solvency ratios. Solvency ratios indicates the liquidity or financial position of a business enterprise, because here we are able to extract the information that how much the funds are available with the firm to pay off its short term obligation as well as the continuous liability which is there on the company in relation to the loan so taken. So, debt paying capacity would also cover under solvency ratios, then the liquidity positions can be ascertained. So, here we divide the solvency ratios again in two segments. The ratios which shows the short term solvency position of a company and the one which shows the long term. In our previous lecture, we have already covered up the solvency ratios which were based on the short term condition or the short term financial capacity of the company, and they consist of current ratios, liquid ratios and acid test ratios. Now, under this lecture, we will deal with the long term solvency ratios. Long term solvency ratios will indicate that what is the amount of the funds available with the company and what is the capacity of the company to pay off debts on a regular basis. So, again we will learn its accounting ratios associated with the solvency position of the company and the interpretation of each and every ratio thereon. Long term solvencies and the stability factors would be considered. Under it, debt ratio is the first ratio which is showing us the long term solvency position of a company. We will learn its computational aspect. Then we will learn about gearing ratio, and debt ratio's computation is being ascertained as follows. It is a debt ratio which consists of total debts, and it is being computed as total debts divided by total assets into 100. So, this is the way debt ratio is being computed. That means, what is the ratio of the debts in relation to the assets a company is having. This way we can ascertain that this much is the portion or the percent of debt a company is having in relation to the assets it is being holding. Debt ratio shows total amount of liabilities to total assets, which we have right now discussed. If debt ratio is too high, that is more than 50%, it is difficult to obtain further financing, and it also has a heavy burden of the interest expenses. Obviously, where debts are more than 50% of the assets, the interest would be paid on a higher side. It will result in the lesser net profits and the lesser prospect of company to get the further funding from the market. So, it should not be on a very higher side. Next one is the gearing ratio. Gearing ratio indicates how much of the business is funded by borrowings. In theory, the higher the level of borrowings means gearing over here, the higher are the risks to a business. Since the payment of interest and repayment of debts are not optional in the same way as dividend, and interest payment is a charge on the profit, we need to pay it. So, gearing ratio, if it is higher, the borrowings are higher, obviously the funding, the profits available would be lower because we need to pay the interest and repayments of loan have to be done. So, what happens that the liquidity position or solvency position can be in a question where the gearing is not maintained adequately. However, gearing can be financially sound part of a business capital structure, particularly if business has strong predictable cash flows. So, here again we want to say that the gearing is not always negative. It can impact a positive impression on the capital structure of the company where the trading on equity option is being exercised and where there is a strong prediction that cash flows would be adequate, then we can go for the gearing and can improve upon our capital structures and can improve the return on equities. Now again under gearing ratios, what happens that it is a prior charge capital. These are the components which will be the ratios. So, it is a ratio of prior charge capital to the total capital into 100. Now, let us elaborate what do we mean by prior charge capital. It is preference share capital plus long term loans. Prior charge capital means those part of the capital onto which we need to pay out to the interested group. That is, if we have taken up loans, we have to pay the interest, and if there is a preference share capital, the dividend which is being paid on a fixed amount or a fixed percentage is to be paid. So, prior charge capital has to be worked out and then we have to ascertain its ratio to the total capital. That means, how much is the amount of the prior charge capital in relation to our total capital. That means, the capital which is having a charge onto it should be expression and that is called the gearing ratio. Here total capital means ordinary share capital, that means the equity share capital, reserves, preference shares plus long term loans. So, that will constitute our total capital and once we are with the figures, we can substitute those figures under gearing ratio and can ascertain the gearing ratio. It is concerned with the company's long term capital structure because they are concerned with the charged capital, that means prior charge capital. So, it will be paid off in number of years rather than a fixed tenure of 1 year. So, obviously, it is going to impact the long term capital structure. A higher gearing ratio indicates a higher portion of funds is obtained from borrowings. It may lead to a long term insolvency. It is difficult to obtain further financing and has to bear a high interest burden. So, these are the problems associated with a higher gearing ratio, that in long term the prospect of company to earn profits may go down because the borrowings would be higher, so will be the interest charge. Ordinary shares may not get any dividends in bad times as very little profit is left over for them. So, this is the premises that in the future the profits would be lesser. So, the chances to pay the dividends to the ordinary shareholders would go down and it will result in the lesser return on equity. So, let us highlight some important features associated with gearing ratio. High geared company, if gearing ratio is high, investment is very risky out there because future prospects would be low, larger dividends will be available in good times, but in bad times there would be chances of very lesser dividends. Low geared company, under it what happens that risk of investment is relatively lower, it is more certain to have dividends. Now, what happens if we made certain changes in the gearing? To reduce gearing, we need to issue ordinary shares. So, our funding should be based on ordinary shares rather than borrowings by redeeming the debentures. If we redeem the debentures, the debt obligation would fall low, the fixed interest charges would be low, profits would be available on a higher side, and if we retain profits, again there can be a change in the gearing ratio. So, profits can be retained where the fixed charges would be low on the profits. And now, if we want to increase the gearing, what we need to do is that we need to issue debentures. And when we issue the debentures, we are financing our capital structure by the debts, and in that way we can buy back the ordinary shares in issue. So, lesser the number of ordinary shares, lesser would be the dividend to be paid, but the financing would be more on the debts or trading on equity can be excised. So, by issuing preference shares also, the gearing ratios can be increased because what we are increasing is the prior charged capital. When we increase the debentures, when we increase preference shares, the charged capital is being increased in relation to the total capital. So, it will gear up the or it will boost up the gearing ratios. So, these are the important aspects which we need to keep in mind when we have to go for the financial analysis of the gearing ratios to be used or not to be used, to enhance or not to be enhanced in a business entity, depending upon the capital structure which is being taken care of and the profits available with the company in the future. Now, where it is being used? The solvency is to be ascertained when investment appraisals are there. So, under that, earning per share have to be computed, price earning ratios are to be computed and dividend covers are to be computed. Now, investment appraisal means that if somebody wants to invest into the company, he will look after the EPS, he will look after price earning ratios and their dividend cover being available to the person concerned. So, again the different formulas are being drafted to compute earnings per share and it is being computed as earnings available to equity shareholders divided by the ordinary number of shares outstanding. So, in that way EPS would be computed. Then price earning ratio, it is a ratio of the market price to the earnings available with the company, that is MPS divided by EPS is to be ascertained. And dividend cover is also to be ascertained using formulas. So, these three formulas are being computed from the investor's point of view where a investment proposal is being taken care of. And dividend yield is to be computed where DPS upon EPS formula is being used and yield basis computational aspect is to be taken care of so that the prospect of getting dividend can be known. Now, let us highlight these formulas again in detail. EPS, that is it is being computed as net profit after tax and preference dividend divided by number of ordinary shares issued which we have discussed right now and ranked for dividends. It shows the profits in dollars associated with each ordinary shares and in the Indian context the amount of money or rupee. A higher EPS indicates investors may have higher confidence in the company, it is more profitable to invest in the shares because it is a ratio of number of shares to the profits. So, profits are being averaged out by the number of shares. So, obviously, if it is on a higher side, the investors would be happier to receive the dividends on a higher side. Now, next is price earning ratio, its formula is market price per share divided by earnings per share and this ratio indicates number of years required to earn the amount invested in the shares. A higher ratio indicates investors have a strong confidence in the company the way EPS was there. An unreasonably high ratio may be the result of speculation in the stock market. Next is dividend cover. It is being computed as net profit after tax and preference dividend divided by ordinary dividend paid and proposed. What does it indicate? It shows the amount of profit that has been distributed as dividend. A low ratio means a large amount of profits have been retained as reserves which can help to finance the operations of the company. A higher ratio means a large amount of profit has been distributed as dividend. The dividend payment is vulnerable unless the company becomes more profitable. And the last in the list is the dividend yield. It is being computed as dividend per share for the year and it is being abbreviated as DPS divided by current market price of the share in 200, that is MPS. So, yield is being computed as DPS divided by MPS in 200 and let us highlight what does it indicates. This ratio measures the rate of return obtained from dividends on investment in shares. A high dividend yield may imply the company is more successful and efficient. It is more profitable to invest in these shares. Now, the next important issue is to understand the limitations which are being associated with ratio analysis. Different definitions of capital employed may cause confusion because there are various methods to ascertain capital employed and it may result in different ratios being computed. Changes in price table will affect the comparability of the ratios between two financial periods. change in external environment will affect the comparison. So, we can say that somehow the interfirm comparison may sometimes be impossible or may not be that appropriate as required. Differences in the management and background of various businesses may affect the comparison. Different accounting definitions, methods, techniques and policies used by the various businesses may affect the comparability. And it is difficult to set up a proper standard for good performance. Short-term fluctuations may not be reflected using the ratio analysis. Now, we are summing up our lecture of today. Under today's lecture, we have learned in detail about one of the important and traditional technique to ascertain return on equity, and it is known as dew point chart. Under dew point chart, we have learned all the important components, that is net profit margin, asset turnover and equity multiplier, which is a financial leverage, and we have multiplied them to ascertain our return on equity. We have learned it in a graphical manner also. Then we have discussed in detail about the solvency ratios and those ratios which are being essential to be computed from the investment appraisal point of view. Under solvency ratios, we have learned about debt ratios and gearing ratio. Other ratios are also there, like debt service coverage ratios and various others which can be computed as we advance ahead. And the other ratios, that is those ratios which are important from the investment appraisal point of view, are EPS ratios, dividend cover ratios, dividend yield ratios, which we have learned in detail with their interpretation and meaning. With this, we are ending up our lecture of today. Thank you.